Yes. So I'm very happy that Luis made it. And Luis, I had the same problem last week, but I am already here for some days. So welcome to our event today, which is on restoration of grasslands, savannas, and rangelands. And I'm very happy to have a very excellent panel here to talk about rangeland grasslands in South America, but also in general. I'm happy to have Luis from the UNCCD with us. And what we want to discuss today is, and to showcase, is really the importance of grassland, rangelands, and savannas. It's a little bit, or it's not a little bit, it's a forgotten ecosystem. So we only have a view of only a short portion is under protection. It's still less than 10%. There's a huge degradation of grassland and savannas, and there is an urgency on restoration. And it's all connected to the people living in the savannas. And I'm very happy that I have also Rurat here from the TRSB, because it's really connected also to the beef producers in these rangelands. And what we want to discuss today is about what is the role of grassland, rangeland, and savannas also in context with biodiversity, but especially in context with climate. And the portion of carbon which is stored in grassland is very high and very often also forgotten. So there is an urgency to protect and sustainably manage grassland. And I'm very happy to have my colleague Oscar Rotos here. He is the director for climate change and policies in Paraguay. He works on grassland and savannas as long as I can think back. So, and Paraguay is also one of the countries WWF is working with. My name, by the way, is Martina Fleckenstein. I'm with WWF International. I'm the global policy manager of for the food practice. And I used to work in my previous position. I was running several projects together with my colleagues on the ground on grassland and savannas. And I think we started with our first project funded by the German government already 2010. And since then, we are working in South America. We had projects in other parts of the world, and today the focus is on South America. So, Nacho, over to you, and I'm very happy that you brought a presentation to us. I think this is an excellent entry to understand what we are talking about in this context. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Martina. It is a pleasure to be here with colleagues from around the world, from South America, Argentina. I want to say a special thanks to the Paraguayan colleagues from the government. We have here Nora and the team. Nora is the director of the Adaptation Department in the National Office of Climate Change. And I really, really appreciate, Nora, you be here with your team in order to build a collaboration between the civil society and the government. And yes, the main message I want to share with you is that we cannot fight climate change without including the rangelands. Savannas, grasslands in South America are very important part of the landscape. And here you have a very typical landscape. It's a mix of the pantanal, the South American wetland, with the Chaco. My country, Paraguay, is a transitional area between these big ecoregions, including the Cerrado. All these natural regions, they are very important in order to fight climate change, because you can see is a very open area, but according to our statistic in our inventories, there's plenty carbon storage in this kind of environment. Next, please. We have to understand that we are in the middle of La Plata Basin in the southern part of South America, and these two polygons that is light green color and the blue color are the light color is the Cerrado and the natural grassland, and the blue is the Pantanal. But in general, they are following the Paraguay River and is is the main space for the open grassland and savannas, rangeland in general in Paraguay. And here in this photo, you can see the transition between the palm savanna, that this is a native species of palm, is the light color here in the photo, and the Chaco forest. Because our rangelands is a mix of patches of forest, savanna palms, and in some portion of this landscape, there is a semi-arid situation. You know, for this reason, I think Lois, your presence here is very important, because the Chaco is considered one of the priority lands for the United Nations Land Degradation Convention. Next, please. As Martina mentioned, there is plenty of biodiversity. This is a beautiful picture of the savanna deer. It is the biggest deer we have there. Moving around the natural grass. This kind of environment is related to the pantanal, but it's connected to the Chaco. It's like a transition between a wetlands and a semi-arid region, very special place in the earth in South America, and for sure the Cerrado Savanna too. Please, next. We are working very closely with the Paraguayan government. I have to mention that everything we have to start a project in Paraguay from the civil society, we have the endorsement of the government, and for us this is a very good support from the Paraguayan government in order to work together, civil society, Paraguayan government, for the sustainable use. Here in this picture you can see that we are not against the cattle development. You can combine cattle ranchers activities with palm savannas in a sustainable manner, and at the same time you can preserve the carbon in the soil. And I think this kind of combination of sustainable production, carbon storage, nature preservation is key for this cut and for climate. Next, please. But at present, there is a lot of developments over there. Here you can see the eucalyptus plantation advancing in the Chaco, Pantanal, and Cerrado landscape, because you know the forest plantation all around the world, they are expanding, and we have to analyze in a very precise way how to balance the expansion of this kind of land use and the carbon balance in the landscape of the savanna and the rangelands. For example, can you go back? For example, in Paraguay, eucalyptus grow 40 cubic meters per hectare per year. Can you imagine that in Australia, is the original place of the eucalyptus, they only grow 4 cubic meters. In Paraguay, they grow 10 times more per hectare than in Australia. That is the reason, because this kind of forest plantation is very attractive in terms of investment in Chaco, Pantanal, Cerrado, and the rangelands. Please. The idea of the sustainable use of the Chaco, Savano, Chaco, Pantanal, and Cerrado in Paraguay is to protect, to manage, and to restore. As Martina mentioned, you can protect, but you have to move forward and take in consideration that you have to restore, because in this picture you can see that sometimes there is a problem with wheat fires in the picture in the left up and right up, sorry. In many cases you have an unbalanced land use affecting the savannas and other land, natural land uses in the Chaco and in the Pantanal. Please go ahead. We already have a study case shared with Argentina, Paraguay, and Colombia in order to share knowledge which in other savannas and rangelands in South America, the Orinoco savannas, the Chaco and the Pantanal in Paraguay, and the Pampas and other savannas and in Argentina. Next, please. This is the focus area in Paraguay. We are working in the Mesopotamian grasslands in the southern part of the country, the humid Chaco and the Cerrado in the central part, and the Pantanal in the north part. And all these areas are key for climate change, and we cannot fight climate change if we doesn't include this kind of natural areas. Only the Chaco is the biggest wilderness area outside the Amazon in South America. I leave this here in order not to take more time, but thanks again for your presence here. And the main message is protect, manage, and restore to preserve and to fight climate change. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Oscar. And I think this is really a very great entry in our discussion for today. And it shows again the importance of this ecosystem. And also, you all know we have the UN decade on ecosystem restoration, where we also managed, or we have really lobbied for this, to bring grassland more in the focus, and that we are not only talking about forest restoration. We are here at the Climate COP, but I think it's very important to connect the three conventions. And I'm very happy to have Louise Baker here. She's the managing director of the Global Mechanism of the UNCCD. And the UNCCD also has a strong focus on grasslands, savannas, and rangelands. And what we really need is to connect the three conventions, the climate, the land, and the biodiversity. And we want to hear a little bit from Louise, what she thinks about, what her advice is, how to bring together those three connections together. And maybe one sentence on this. We have grasslands mentioned in the land degradation neutrality, which are voluntary under the UNCCD. And WWF just has done an assessment on the NDCs. And also grasslands are mentioned. But there is still very often no alignment, and that's exactly where we might need to work towards.
Thanks, Martina, and thanks, Oscar. Hi, everybody. I'm Louise Baker, and I'm really sorry. I was the reason we were late. I got totally lost, completely lost in this place. Do not drop me in the middle of a grassland. In fact, I'll never find my way out. Maybe there are better signposts in the grasslands. There probably are. Right. So as Martina said, I am the managing director of the Global Mechanism at UNCCD, and we're the kind of implementing arm of UNCCD. We're not operational, but just we help countries frame their targets and frame their projects and try to kind of deliver on their ambitions. And in this context, actually, it's since we've been talking about it, but I realize that it happens so often now. It's actually terrifying to me. I have conversations with countries that go, "It's okay, climate change, we're going to plant some trees." Great. Where are you going to plant some trees? Well, we've got this big empty space. And you think, I knew this had happened, but since we've been talking about it really consistently, I realized that this conversation, that people think that the grasslands and the rangelands are empty, is a conversation that is happening. And it's happening at really the highest levels amongst well-meaning people who are trying to fight climate change and are being really strong. Yeah, so I think the first thing that I think we need to do is we need to make sure that people understand and value the grasslands, the rangelands, the savannas for what they are. We need to maintain them. We need to ensure that the quality of this land is sustained and improved, but they have to have value in themselves and recognized for the economic, social, cultural, environmental values that they've got. So that was the first thing. And I really like this. I rarely like my boss's speeches. They're quite boring, but they really are. I mean, oof. No, I used to. I don't anymore. They've got worse. but I did like a statement. He launched the one, or is part of the launch for the Rangelands Atlas. And he highlighted five of the myths about modern pastoralism in his speech. And I thought it was very good. So I don't give him enough credit. So I'm giving him credit now. This is good. That pastoralism is an archaic form of production, not adapted to modernity. Okay, these are myths, right? Okay. All conflicts are caused by pastoralists. We get a lot of that, particularly I work a lot in the Sahel region, where pastoralists are blamed for the conflicts quite often. Rangelands are degraded because of overstocking and overpopulation. Pastoralism destroys biodiversity and leads to desertification. And pastoralists overgraze their land. These are myths, they're absolute myths, and they need debunking. So we need to be working collectively on a plan to ensure the proper value of the rangelands is recognized, that the rangelands are well managed, that there's the investment into the rangelands that enables these communities to live their best life, to live at an optimal level. From our side, we are aiming, and we do aim, to restore approximately, under our convention, 450 million. In fact, globally, under all of the processes, close to 1 billion hectares have been pledged for restoration under... Okay, good. close to 1 billion hectares have been pledged for restoration. Under the NDCs, under biodiversity targets, under the Bond Challenge, different processes. So there's a lot of land out there that the international community says it wants to protect and restore. But if you are a pastoralist or a farmer, you're only taking one action. You're living your life. You're living your best life, hopefully, but you're living your life. You're taking care of your cattle. You're planting your crops. They are not taking action for climate change or for biodiversity or for land. They're certainly not doing it individually. They're doing it as a collective way of life. And I think we're getting to the stage now where these targets can be aligned, and the projects that are developed can be aligned. We are, we hope, Martina, working positively towards the International Year of Rangelands and Pastoralists, which is 2026. And collectively with WWF and some of our other partners, we're going to be looking at a global program funded that's an investment program into the rangelands. We hope that there will be a significant amount. So normally when you have an international year, it's just communications activities, yeah? People say, oh, that's nice. This time we'd actually like to have the money in advance and start doing work in that year. UNCCD will host its COP in Mongolia in 2026. You're all very, very welcome to that, where we hope we'll have something really substantial to invest in. To make that work, we're going to need all of the partners from the Decade on Ecosystem Restoration, but all of the partners working in the rangelands as well. So watch this space. There will be something, we hope, at real scale in all, Latin America, Africa, and Asia, coming up and being designed in the next couple of years, that's something significant to help operations on the ground. But I'm going to stop there because I could talk all day as well about this too. But thank you so much for being here, and please count on us as we move forward on this agenda. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Louise. And it's always a pleasure listening to you. And thanks for being here. And thanks really also for pointing out the International Year of Rangeland and Pastoralist. I think this is a very, very important year for us, and working towards this and having a program together with all of you. It will not be one country, it will not be one organization. Only if we work together and strengthen the importance of rangeland and grassland and savannas on the protection, on the restoration, and on the management, it would be great to have a big launch with commitments, and also we need implementation. We need really to showcase how it works on the ground. We need to share lessons learned. And as Oscar already mentioned, WWF is currently fortunately funded through the German government, working in 3 countries in South America, in Argentina, Colombia, and Paraguay on this topic. And I'm very happy also to have Martin, where is he? to have Martin Ilescas from Argentina here, is the General Director of Projects with External Financing and International Cooperation in the Argentina's Ministry of Environment and Sustainable Development. And we want to hear a little bit from you, what's happening in the Chaco in Argentina, and a little bit also to learn from you what your government, how it sees grassland savannas as a priority, hopefully. Over to you. And I think Luis has to leave. She has another event. So good luck. Thanks for being here, Luis, and let's stay in contact.
Thank you, Luis. Lovely words. I would like to have a word with you maybe later, because okay, you have mentioned some interesting things. Yeah. So may I say that it feels like I'm on a stand-up comedy show, so and I don't feel comfortable with that. Okay, sorry. Well, I'm not going to repeat here. Okay. So I'm not going to repeat what my colleague from Paraguay mentioned about the project we have in common with Fundación Vida Silvestre. Thank you, Daniela, for inviting me. Thank you, Ika, for giving us this space. So I would like to change a little bit my presentation, and I will move to the priorities of the Argentinian government. As you mentioned, recently we have passed or we approved our national plan on adaptation and mitigation. It is quite important. It's not an official document of the UNFCCC, but it is established in our climate change law. That was the result or the product of the work of many people, civil society, indigenous and local communities, NGOs, university, academia. Okay, again, it's not here. So I recap. Good. So that was a work that took us like 2 years. But as you may know, the grasslands are all over the world, is one of the biggest ecosystems of the world, and Argentina is not the exception. And talking about my country, you can say, okay, Argentina, grasslands, La Pampa. But it's not only La Pampa. If you go to Patagonia, one third of the territory of Patagonia are covered by grasslands. And as my colleague just mentioned, we cannot put aside three dimensions. We cannot talk of grasslands or conservation without thinking about livelihoods or climate change. So you need to integrate all those measures. You put all the things in the models, and that will come up with a very good result. Talking about that plan on adaptation and mitigation, I was doing my homework yesterday and just reading it, because we set 250 measures in that plan. And over 20 measures are related to grasslands. I grouped them in 5 categories. It's my decision. It was my approach. And so first, we have the activities related to fire management. For instance, in the Ministry of Environment, we have the fire management program. It's a very interesting activity. It's funded by the 3% of every insurance policy of the country. Unfortunately, last year and this year, we've been having or facing huge issues with grasslands fires. So it demands a lot of money, a lot of effort, and well, we share that problem with Paraguay and Bolivia, and we have a strong coordination between the countries of the region. We give each other support, so it's very important. On the second item would be research and applied sciences for conservation of grasslands with climate change perspective. The third one would be sustainable management practices of grazing, cattle raising. And at that point, something that would interest to you is that we passed last year, or we've been working last year in our national plan on forest management integrated with livestock. As the Minister of Environment, we have the responsibility of taking care of the native forest. Agriculture, they have the plantations. So sometimes we have these discussions between plantations and forest management. And that is why I said to my colleague, we need to have a discussion over that. The fourth point is ecosystem restoration and improved management of degraded lands. It's a huge challenge in Argentina. And the last one, and that's a thing that is very important for us because the National Parks Administration is part of the Ministry of Environment, is the incorporation of new and underrepresented areas to the national park systems. So we are trying to create a new park in Santa Fe, which is near to Paraguay. We have just one province in the middle. And so those are the five key elements I would like to highlight here. But another thing that for me is quite important in terms of international cooperation, that is the solution or the projects or the implementation of activities in the grasslands is not something that it could be carried out only by the government. So we need that relation, correlation, and synergies between the private sector, the civil society, the government, because if we don't have that kind of coordination, it would be impossible. Going to the our neighbors here of Chaco and Paraguay and Colombia, we are part of that IGI project with Fundación Vida Silvestre. We are very excited to start working on that project. IGI takes a very long process to pass each project. We will do our best. And Daniela, maybe it's something you don't know, but I can tell you maybe in the next days we will have that note signed. It's an internal conversation because we need to give our approval for the project. So I think those are our main messages here from the Argentinian government side. We are fully committed in the grasslands conservation, restoration, and sustainable use. And well, that was all. Thank you for hearing me, and thank you for being here so early in the morning and in the second week of COP.
Thank you, and I take this with the approver with me. So that would be great, and because this is important for the IGI project. It's encouraging to hear all the measures you have in your NAP or adaptation program and the mitigation. I have a quick question. Did you also have ideas how to finance all this, or is this a challenge? That would be interesting. Just one more question. I think there is a second microphone over here.
Yes, well, that's the big issue. And now the negotiations here and the discussions are over the finance matter. And in terms of activities, well, I will give you just one example. The National Parks Administration created a foundation 15 days ago. We are trying to find ways to finance activities, channeling resources from the private sector, civil society, international organizations, MDBs, or whatever. But also, we are developing a new system of, we will try to work with the national budget to give a specific funding to the National Parks Administration. It's something that we are discussing with the Treasury, actually. And of course, we consider international financing. We are working with the MDBs very closely, also with ICI or the foundations, but all the measures needed to finance the activities are considered in the National Adaptation and Mitigation Plan. But still, we need more resources. The surface of Argentina is huge. The same goes for Paraguay, Brazil, and Colombia. We are big countries, and we need those resources, especially when CBD is coming and the new goal maybe will be set 30-30. So covering that 30% of land or 30% of seas will demand a lot of resources.
Thank you. We will. I would like to have to ask Oscar to come to the stage again, and we will have time for questions. And by the way, I have to excuse Ulises Lovera. He had on a short note. He had another meeting, so that's why he could not participate. But I'm happy to have the colleagues from Paraguay here. Also, if there are questions, we could also take the questions to you. So are there any questions from here, from or any feedback, comment, edit, anything additional, what we have heard so far? And please introduce yourself.
Well, thank you. My name is Lloyd Day. I'm the Deputy Director General of ICA, the sponsors of this pavilion. Muchísimas gracias por estar aquí con nosotros. Dos grandes países de nuestros miembros, sorry, I'll speak in English since we're speaking in English, two great member countries of ICA covering the Gran Chaco, a region of our Latin America that's so important to protect, manage, restore, and conserve. My question is, as we talked about, Luisa did a great job, even though she was late, talking about the myths of grasslands. And it's wonderful to know about the International Year of Grasslands and Pastures. So thank you for bringing that up. What more can be done to educate, I'd say, consumers, the public, about the importance of grasslands so that we just don't, and political officials, that's what we do, right? About the importance of grasslands and their importance for the soil and for carbon sequestration. I'm looking at my friends here from Canada, from the Canadian Roundtable on Sustainable Beef, as well as the Canadian Cattlemen, and the importance of pastures in North America as well, and the fact that animals are an important part of she's not the animal, but she talks about the importance of livestock. She's not listening, she's on her phone. That's you. The importance of animals managing grasslands. There's huge ignorance about that. Can you maybe share a little bit about what we can do as ICA, working with our ministers? You work with ministers, you know how important it is to educate them. And then beyond that, how do we work with partners like the WWF and others to help spread the message of the importance of animals helping manage our pastures and grasslands for soil, et cetera? Thank you.
Thank you. I think it's a very, very important question, and I think both of you will have some ideas and answers. So yes. Over to you.
Yes, for sure. And I will use the words of Martin that we have to work together, civil society, government, and the international organization like ICA and others. And we are founder members of the chapter of the sustainable beef production in Paraguay. Last week, my colleagues from WWF Paraguay, they was in at the United States, being part of the global meeting of the USB. Yesterday, we was celebrating with cattle ranchers in Paraguay the best practices. We every year we have a special night with cattle ranchers and civil society to celebrate the sustainable management of the grasslands, because Paraguay, you know, is the number six or number exporter of meat, cattle meat in the world. Can you imagine that a country in South America is a big player on the meat market, and we are the number four exporter of soybean in the world. South America in general is a key player for this kind of agriculture and cattle commodities. And for this reason, I think the answer is yes. We have to balance agriculture with conservation. We are not against agriculture. We are working with farmers, with cattle ranches together in order to preserve the balance between these two aspects in these big natural spaces in South America. Thank you very much.
Well, in terms of education, I will take two examples and then one practical example. It's we passed two important laws in Argentina. One, the climate change education law. So now climate change is embedded in every educational level, from kindergarten up to university. And the second one is the Ley Yolanda. It's for the official officers. We need to take some courses regarding climate change, and so it's mandatory. We are the national authority of that. So, and the third example is something you mentioned recently. Is we have a project from the GCF. It's a result-based payment program, and in that program, the cattle management or the forest management integrated with livestock has a component of institutional strengthening and capacity building. I think those are maybe the three measures that I can mention regarding the importance of the animals, the importance of the ecosystems in Argentina. We need to develop those capacities in the society, in the government, and at all levels. I mean, so that could be the three examples, short examples I have to share with you.
Thank you. And okay, yeah, that I would have give you the microphone. So I start with Rurite and then I hand over to you, because as mentioned, also the private sector is very important, and we really want to get and hear from you.
Thanks. Thanks so much, Martina, and thanks to the presenters as well. So we heard how important the savannas and grasslands, rangelands are at storing carbon. And I think in Canada, you've got a sort of rough figure on what you think is stored in terms of tons, and it's a billion, right? It's more than a billion tons of carbon in your rangelands in Canada. I'd be interested to know if we have any sort of figures for that in both Paraguay and Argentina, and if we're monitoring the change in that status, because I think it's really important for us to show the world that not only are we there at sustaining the carbon stocks, but we're actually capable of increasing them.
Well, it's a good question. We are actually running some field studies about that in the Secretary of Climate Change of Argentina. We are working together with INTA, is the National Institution of Agricultural Technology, and also with CONICET, is the Council of Science and whatever, is the Ministry of Technology. And also we have some discussions with the IPCC methodology about the carbon capture of grasslands. So yes, we are working also closely to the Ministry of Agriculture, Secretary of Agriculture, Fisheries, and about that topic. So that is something that we will have in the near future.
Thank you very much for the question. Yes, we have to talk about metrics. Can you imagine that in average, according to our studies, the rangelands in Paraguay have a median of 100 tons of carbon per hectare, according to the first studies. In these rangelands in Paraguay is like a 60% of the country total area, and is around 22 million hectares, and you have to multiply 22 million hectares per 100 tons of carbon per hectare, and is a big portion of the carbon storage in my country. Yes, for sure.
And I think you just said why it's so important. We're about 1.5 billion is what we estimate is stored under native pasture. But I wanted to go back. I'm Bob Lowe. I'm the Vice President of the Global Roundtable and also the past president of the Canadian Cattle Association. Back to what you were asking, Lloyd, and What we've found in Canada, if we can get environmental NGOs to talk for us, works way better. And I don't know if you've seen it, it's been shown here, and thanks to IECA, we put out a short little video called Guardians of the Grasslands. With Ducks Unlimited Canada and with Nature Conservancy Canada. And that's been a huge hit. It's going through the schools. It's been a really good way of getting our word across.
Thank you. Very interesting. I think you said exactly this, showing lessons learned, showing examples. It's very, very important.
Hi, I'm Josefina Iselen for the Global Roundtable for Sustainable Beef together with Rory. Hi, Oscar. Hi, Martin. Yeah, no, I just wanted to ask, as at the Global Roundtable, we always work in collaboration with civil society, but also with the private sector. And how do you see the private sector really taking action on this carbon measurement, on this conservation of grasslands, and on our sector on beef? They are the ones that sell the product at the end to national and export it. So do you see that they're really involved, they're really taking action, or how do you see their...
Thank you very much. Yes, as I mentioned earlier, yesterday or 2 days ago, we celebrate our annual meeting with the cattle ranchers in Paraguay, civil society, WWF, with the cattle ranchers. We celebrate that there is a program, a voluntary program in Paraguay, and the program is called the Sustainability Champions. And every year we put on the stage the champions, the cattle rancher champions, showing that it's possible to self-evaluation of sustainability and to voluntarily implement the best practices. Why WWF is working with this kind of engagement with the private sector? Because we are founder of the Sustainable and Responsible Soybean Global Roundtable. We are member founder on the Forest Stewardship Council, and it's a natural pathway to be part of the cattle rancher roundtable too. This is the main message. We have to work together, and we have to celebrate our step-by-step accomplishment. I want to mention a very interesting data about Paraguay and Canada. We have 25,000 people with double nationality, Paraguayan and Canadian. Can you imagine? The best meat producer, cattle rancher, number one exporter in Paraguay are the Paraguayan Canadian, coming from the Manitoba, Winkler area and Winnipeg area, because they are Mennonites. They are people coming from Europe to America to be cattle ranchers and farmers, and they are very successful. But to be successfully in terms of economic development, you have to put in contrast with the environment and the social issues. And now the Mennonites organization, they are the biggest exporter of meat in Paraguay. They are not approaching us in order to work together. They are part of the private sector, but they are part of the cooperative. You know, cooperative is like an association of producers working together. And we are working very closely. Because as you mentioned, if we, civil society, were apart, besides the private sector, we cannot move forward. Totally agree with you. Thank you very much.
Good morning, Lufingo with Emerging Ag. Not necessarily a question, but a comment. Lufingo Mwamakamba with Emerging Ag. Not necessarily a question, but a comment building on what you just said. I want to commend the platform that we are using right now, the AICA Pavilion. I've been here from last week and this second week and looking at the different events that have been taking place, the different stakeholders that have been coming, like-minded institutions and also others, building on what we're discussing right now, presenting that platform for different stakeholders to come and share and learn. And I hope such a platform will build not just from here, also build further beyond this gathering. Thank you.
Hi, thank you. Daniela Gomel from Fundación Villa Silvestre. Very thankful to have Martin here. I just wanted to ask you if you could expand a bit on the measures related to cattle raising and restoration in the plan, or which ones are prioritized or about to be implemented soon. And then just a clarification, because I was trying to write down and I couldn't. The national park that you were evaluating to create, which one was that?
Jaucanigas. It's the National Park Jaucanigas in Santa Fe. Well, the MBGI plans, which is the forest management integrated with livestock, will be defined by each province. So we will be the national authority, and then as a federal country, we will have local committees, and they will decide which plans are approved or not. So, and that's for the private sector. So that's how it will work in the future. We are about to, we are in the final, doing the final arrangements of this agreement between the ministries, due to some changes in the Argentinian government, because the Ministry of Agriculture was absorbed by the Ministry of Economy. So we need to change some authorities in the final contract. And then the provinces will sign, and then we will start applying the projects in the whole country.
Thank you. We are at the end of this session, and I always have one question to my panelists, and I start with Oscar. What do you expect as an outcome from the COP considering rangeland, grassland, and savannas?
Yes, my expectation is to work together to protect, preserve, and restore the rangelands around the world. And I hope we can find a common space in order to put more effort to put on the stage the good work the cattle ranchers are doing as guardian of the grassland. This is my expectation. Thank you very
much. Thank you, and over to you.
Well, regarding COP, and I think ICA has played or is playing an important role regarding cattle ranching, and I think especially the Latin American countries have a lot to show to the world. I didn't answer your question, but I think the private sector can show the world that you are low carbon producers. So that's the main message you can deliver to the world, and you need to share those practices. Maybe you can export not only your goods but only your practices. Well, the message I share your comments, your final comments about COP. We need to work together closely for the future, because the agri-food systems will guarantee the food of the people, actually. So.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for participating today. I wish to carry over this energy and highlighting the importance of grassland, savannas, and rangelands to the Biodiversity COP, which is happening in, I think it's just 3 weeks ahead. So it would be good that we have the same focus, the same discussions, and also bring the importance of grassland, savannas, rangelands in the new post-2020 global biodiversity framework. Thank you once again, and have a nice day. Gracias.